हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। आई एम ख्वाजा आसिफुल्ला, लेक्चरर इन केमिस्ट्री फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट डिग्री कॉलेज फलकनुमा हैदराबाद। टुडे आई प्रेजेंट वीडियो लेसन ऑन केमिस्ट्री ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्सेस in which we will discuss valence bond theory, or in short VBT. Since it's a continuation of different lessons or topics are covered in different parts, it is sixth part of the series. Valence bond theory was proposed by Pauling. It's a simple theory which explains the structure and the magnetic properties of complexes or coordination compounds. Structure and magnetic properties of a large number of complexes can be explained with the help of valence bond theory. Main or salient features of this theory are as follows. Number one, the central metal ion has a number of empty orbitals which can accommodate electrons donated by the ligands. Means the central metal ion, which are the ions formed from d block elements or transition metals, will possess vacant d orbitals and they will readily accept the pairs of electrons donated by the ligands. And the ligands are the molecules or ions, like molecules of water, ammonia, ethylene diamine, etc., or ions like chloride, cyanide, nitrosive, etc. The number of empty orbitals in which the accepted pairs of electron will accommodate will be equal to the coordination number of the central metal ion for that particular complex compound. Means the number of electron pairs accepted by the metal ion will be equal to the vacant orbitals present in that ion, and it is called as coordination number. Next point is the metal orbitals and ligand orbitals overlap to form strong bonds. You know that orbitals are present in an atom or ion, so both central metal ion and the ligands will have orbitals. The difference is the metal ion will have vacant orbitals, whereas the ligand will have paired electrons in its orbitals, and it will donate those pairs of electrons to metal ion, and it will form bond with central metal ions, one or more bonds. These type of bonds are called as coordinate bond or DQ bonds, generally represented by a narrow mark. The stability of complex depends on the extent of overlapping of orbitals. To achieve greater stability, the atomic orbitals like s, p, and d orbitals of the central metal ion undergo hybridization. We have to recall that when a bond is formed, when a covalent bond is formed, actually there will be overlapping of orbitals of two atoms which are taking part in bonding. For example, if two atoms like hydrogen atoms are taking part in bonding, then both the hydrogen atoms will have one electron each in their s orbital when they overlap. Their overlapping is called SS overlapping, and they will produce sigma orbitals, which are SS sigma orbitals. And if the overlapping is up to maximum extent, the bond will be strong. Similarly, if the extent of overlapping is less or minimum, then the bond will be weak. But you know, in an atom, there will be different orbitals like s, p, d, and f, and they will have different energies, or in other words, energies of these orbitals will not be same or similar. So to avoid the difference in energy and the strength of bond between the central metal ion and the ligand in a complex, the orbitals of central metal ion will undergo hybridization. What is hybridization? It is a process in which the orbitals which have different energies, or they are called degenerate orbitals, there will be slight difference in energies of these orbitals, will undergo hybridization and will produce same number of orbitals, but here the energies will also be same, and these hybridized orbitals will be named according to the type of orbitals which undergo hybridization. For example, if one s orbital and one p orbital undergo hybridization, the hybridization will be called as sp hybridization. If one s and two p orbitals undergo hybridization, the type of hybridization is called sp2. Similarly, if one s and three p orbitals are undergoing hybridization, it is called sp3. One d orbital, one s orbital, three p orbitals, then it is called dsp3 or sp3d. Similarly, two d orbitals are involved, then d2sp3 or sp3d2. These types of hybridization the central metal ion may undergo to form orbitals with same energy, and the number of orbitals will be equal to the number of orbitals before they undergo hybridization. So they will produce a new set of equivalent hybridized orbitals with definite directional properties. You know that except for s orbital, which is spherical in shape, the other orbitals like p, d, f will have their orbitals orient in different directions in the space. For example, if we take p orbital, in p sublevel, there will be three p orbitals, and they will be perpendicular to each other. in px orbital, lobes will be on the x-axis. In py, lobes are on y-axis. Therefore, they will be perpendicular to each other. As a result, they will contribute to the shape of the molecule. Why? Because during the process of hybridization, the newly formed orbitals will take positions in different directions, making certain angles. For example, if we take sp hybridization, only two orbitals are there. They will lie in same line, so the shape of the molecule in which the central metal atom undergoes sp hybridization will have linear shape with a bond angle 180 degrees. For like this, for sp2 it will be triangular, for sp3 it will be tetrahedral. Okay, for dsp3 or sp3d, it will be trigonal, bipyramidal. For d2sp3 or sp3d2, it will be octahedral. These four will lie in same plane, producing a square plane, and these two will be perpendicular to that plane. Therefore, when we join the corners with this point, we'll get four planes below also. Therefore, it is called octahedral. So in this way, different types of hybridization will produce different shapes, or they will contribute to the shape of the molecule or ion of the complex. These hybrid orbitals undergo overlapping with orbitals of ligand to form strong bonds. The meaning is, the central metal ion is undergoing hybridization and forming hybridized orbitals. Those hybridized orbitals will overlap with the orbitals of ligand and will produce or form bonds, which are strong bonds. Now, this is the illustration of sp hybridization. As I told you just now, sp hybridization means the metal atom or any central atom will undergo sp hybridization in this way. One s orbital of that atom will mix with one p orbital, this type of intermixing of orbitals, to produce two sp orbitals which are hybridized orbitals, which are called hybridized orbitals. This is sp hybridization. And they will produce two different orbitals, but with same energy, because these are hybrid. And the shape is linear. They are lying in one line, and the bond angle is 180 degrees. Now, after formation of these hybridized orbitals, if there is ligand molecule that will approach towards this from this direction, another from this direction, and they will overlap with this orbital. One will overlap here, one will overlap here. One orbital of one ligand will overlap here, another here, producing linear molecule with 180 as bond angle. Now, because we have different type of hybridization, as I told you just now, they will have different structures. If it is sp hybridization, means it's a two ligand, as just now I told you here, two ligand molecules or atoms or ions will approach from two different directions, one from this, another from this. So two ligand molecules or ions will involve overlapping here, producing linear structure. If three ligands are there, they will approach from three different directions, producing triangular planar or trigonal planar. If there are four ligands and the hybridization is ST3 type, then they will produce tetrahedral structure. As just now, I have given this tetrahedral. Four ligands will approach from four different directions, one from here, second, third, fourth, and they will overlap with these orbitals. These lines represent four hybridized orbitals. Those orbitals of ligand will overlap here, one, second, third, fourth. In this way, they will overlap. This also gives you an idea, this figure will also give you an idea that this is a linear shape. These orbitals which are not taking part in hybridization will not contribute to the shape of the molecule. Only these two will contribute to the shape of orbital, this blue color. And these blue color orbitals are actually sp hybridized orbitals of central atom or central metal atom in the case of complex. And this s orbital, maybe it is s or any other, it is of ligand which is overlapped with this. Because it is spherical in shape, therefore we can say it is s orbital. So the bond formed with the overlapping of s and sp orbital may be called as ssp sigma bond. Here also ssp sigma bond, right? This is s orbital of ligand, this is sp hybridized orbital of the central atom or central metal ion. This trigonal shape, all three orbitals which are hybridized orbitals lying in the same plane with three corners, so trigonal planar, same plane. And these orbitals which are perpendicular to the plane will not contribute to the shape of the molecular ion of the complex compound or coordination compound. If sp3 hybridization is there, the shape will be tetrahedral. In tetrahedral, just now I told you, the ligand molecules will approach from four different directions. One from this, second, third, fourth. And here, these are blue color orbitals are hybridized orbitals of central metal ion, which are undergoing sp3 hybridization. And every sp3 hybridized orbital will overlap with orbital of ligand in this way, producing tetrahedral shape with bond angle 109, about 109 degrees, 28 degrees. Here the bond angle will be 120 degrees, here 180 degrees in this way. So this will produce different shapes. DSP3 means 1D, 1S and 3P orbitals, square planar. Square planar means like this. This is a square plane. If we join four points, we get a square, and all the atoms are in same plane. Central metal ion plus these four atoms, all are in same plane. Therefore, it is square planar. Now, for this, it is trigonal pyramidal. And for sp3, d2, or d2, sp3, here, there will be two different conditions, dsp3 or sp3d. sp3d and here d2 sp3 also, both will have octahedral shape. So this is for d2 dsp3, this is for d2 sp3 or sp3 d2. It is octahedral and this is triangular bipyramidal. So again, we can have at a glance types of hybridization and geometry of the molecules of the complexes. If it is sp hybridization, linear, sp2 triangular planar, sp3 tetrahedral, dsp2 square planar, d2 sp3 octahedral, d3 sp3 pentagonal bipyramidal. Pentagonal bipyramidal. for D2SP3, there are 3 plus 1, 4 plus 2, 6 atoms. Or 6, I'm sorry, 6 orbitals, not atoms, 6 orbitals, hybridized orbitals. Therefore, the shape will be octahedral. Here, 7 out of 7, 5 will make a plane with 5 sides or 5 corners. One will be lying above the plane, the other will be lying below the plane, giving you the shape pentagonal bipyramidal. As we see here, for D2SP3, it is the case. If D3SP3 is there, one more atom will be there. So 5 corners, pentagon, and 2 pyramids, bipyramidal. In this way, we can understand different shape for different complexes or molecules of different complexes, which have different shapes. Similarly, here also it summarized, we can summarize like this. It is a linear one in which both the atoms of ligands or molecules of ligand are lying in the same plane. Here sp3, square planar, triangular bipyramidal, and octagonal. So the third important point in the theory is the d orbitals involved in the hybridization may be either from inner orbit or from outer orbit. In every atom, last orbit will be called as nth orbit. So if an atom like d orbital in an atom, d orbital belongs to penultimate shell, it is called inner orbit, and it will be called as n minus 1 d orbital. So if n minus 1 d orbital is taking part in hybridization, these are called inner or n minus 1 d orbitals. If d orbital which is taking part in hybridization also belongs to nth orbit or the last orbit, then it is called outer or nd orbital. So these complexes will be of two types, inner and outer. Similarly, they are named as low spin and high spin complexes, depending upon the d orbital which is involved in hybridization or in bonding also. If it is n minus 1th orbit or penultimate shell involved, then it is called low spin complex. If the d orbital from nth orbit is involved in hybridization, then it is called high spin complex. Next is the non-bonding metal electrons occupy the inner d orbitals which do not participate in hybridization and thus in bond formation with the ligand. Sometimes there will be electrons present in n minus 1th orbit or inner orbit which will not participate in the bond formation because they do not take part in hybridization. Next is each ligand contains a lone pair of electrons. Every ligand will donate a pair of electrons. How? When it contains a lone pair of electrons, then only it can donate. Next point, a covalent bond is formed by the overlap of a vacant hybridized metal orbital and a filled orbital of the ligand. As I told you earlier also, there will be vacant d orbitals available in central metal ion, and the ligand will contain lone pair or extra pairs of electrons which it can donate to the central metal ion to form a bond. How they will form bond? Before formation of bond, orbitals of central metal ion will undergo hybridization, and these hybridized orbitals will overlap with the filled orbitals of the ligand. The bond is called as coordinate bond or coordinate covalent bond because it is a covalent bond in nature. Next point is, if the complex contains unpaired electrons, because this theory not only explains the structure of the complex, but it also explains the magnetic property of the complex. So it is explained in this postulate or the point that if a complex contains unpaired electron, it will be paramagnetic in nature. If it do not contain any unpaired electron, then it will be diamagnetic in nature. So the number of unpaired electrons in the complex point out the geometry of the complex and the magnetic property of the complex. And in practice, the number of unpaired electrons in a complex is found from the magnetic movement measurements as given below. You know that we can predict the nature, magnetic nature of a molecule depending upon the paired or unpaired electrons. If unpaired electrons are available in a molecule or ion, it is paramagnetic in nature. And if it has all paired electrons, it is diamagnetic in nature. And depending upon the magnetic movement of the molecule, we measure or calculate theoretically or experimentally, we can say how many number of electrons it will have in it which are unpaired. And you know, the magnetic movement is given by mu. And the formula of magnetic movement is nothing but under root n into n plus 2. Bm here is the unit of magnetic movement, called as Bohr magneton. And n is number of unpaired electrons. And we can have relation as follows. The value of magnetic movement given in Bohr magneton, that is mu in Bohr magneton. And from this value, we can say whether a particular molecular ion of complex compound or coordination compound possess unpaired electron or not. If it possess, how many unpaired electrons are available in that molecular ion? For example, if the magnetic moment is zero, we can say that it has no unpaired electron or it is diamagnetic in nature. If it has one or more electrons which are unpaired, then it is paramagnetic, and depending upon the value of magnetic moment, we can say it has one electron, two electrons, or three unpaired electrons, etc. If the value of mu is 1.73, then it has one unpaired electron in it. If its value is 2.83 or around it, it may contain two unpaired electrons. For mu is equal to 3.87, three unpaired electrons. For mu is equal to 4.9, it will have four unpaired electrons. If the value is about 6, or the value of mu is 5.92, the molecular ion of the complex will contain five unpaired electrons. So with the value of mu, if we know the value of mu, we can predict the number of unpaired electrons present in the molecular ion of the complex. Now, one more thing you have to remember from this theory is that it says Under the influence of a strong ligand, the electrons can be forced to pair up against the Hund's rule. What is Hund's rule? Hund's rule says that until and unless all degenerate orbitals are half filled, pairing in those orbitals will not start. But here we are assuming against the Hund's rule, it happens that the pairing of electrons start in degenerate orbitals. But how? When ligand approaches, ligand molecular ion approaches to the central metal ion, there will be change in energy of the orbitals available in the central metal ion, and pairing starts. So you have to remember that here the energy of orbitals of ligand influence the energy of orbitals of central metal ion. As a result, electrons which were unpaired before the approach of ligand will be paired up, and this is against the Hund's rule. You have to keep it in mind. So let us now consider the following complexes. Means we will take few examples of complexes to understand the valence bond theory. First, we will consider octahedral complexes. Octahedral complexes are those complexes in which two d orbitals and one s orbital and three p orbitals undergo hybridization, or it is called d2sp3 hybridization or sp3d2 hybridization. And these will be of two types. One called as inner orbital or n-1d orbital complexes, because here in this type of complexes, n-1d or d orbital of penultimate shell is taking part in hybridization and also in making bonds. So n-1d electrons will make use of bonding. Actually, this will be empty. After hybridization is empty, n-1d orbitals will share electrons of ligand to form coordinate covalent bond. So, what are inner orbitals complexes? These complexes result from d2sp3 hybridization, means here inner d orbital is utilized. Outer orbital are nd orbital complexes. In these complexes, nd orbital means orbital from nth level or the last level is taking part in hybridization. It participates in hybridization as well as in the overlapping with the ligand orbitals to form bond. And this type of hybridization is called sp3d2. So sp3d2 represents that, or it gives you an idea that this d orbital is from nth orbit. First we will take inner orbital or n-1d orbital complexes. For that we are taking example of potassium ferrocyanide, or in IUPAC system it is called as potassium hexacyanoferrate 2, whose formula is K4FeCN taken 6 times, or if it is ion, it will be in ionic form. So central part or complex ion or coordination sphere has a negative charge. Here 4 negative charges, means it is in anionic form. Now whether it is anion or a molecule, here we need to consider Fe, which is the central metal ion. Here, Fe e means its atomic number, z will be 26. This 26th element of the periodic table in first step. Here you have to remember that central metal ion first loses electrons, then gains electron. So in first step, it loses an electron to have a particular oxidation state. Here it is losing two electrons, means it has two as oxidation state, or plus two is the oxidation state of this ion. It is called ferrous. In second step, now it is having 2 minus, means 26 minus 2, that will be 24 electrons here. In second step, it accepts 6 pairs of electrons, or 12 electrons in total, to achieve atomic number of krypton. How? Fe2 plus the ferrous ion will have 24 electrons. Now it is gaining 12 electrons, or accepting 12 electrons, or 6 pairs, means the total will be 36 electrons. It will have set up effective atomic number being 36. Therefore, it will be krypton. During the process, electrons will be paired in d orbital against the control, providing 2B and S and 3P orbitals which undergo hybridization, or they will intermix to produce B2 SP3 hybridized orbitals, or it is called B2 SP3 hybridization. And you know, B2 SP3 hybridization, or essential metal ion undergoes B2 SP3 hybridization, the shape is octahedral. These are four ligand molecules or ions occupying four corners of the plane, one above the plane, other below the plane, producing octahedral shape. Here we have different hybridization and different shapes as we discussed earlier. Now, for this example, which is hexamine cobalt trifluoride. The second example, in this central metal atom is cobalt, and it has 27 as its atomic number. In first stage, it will lose 3 electrons to produce trivalent cation, and it will be 24. It will be having 24 electrons. Now it will accept 6 pairs of electrons. So it is again 24 plus 2 into 6, that is 12, means 36. So the new atomic number of cobalt in this particular complex, or it is its effective atomic number, is 36, which is equal to the atomic number of krypton, which is a member of noble gas. Now, because it is undergoing B2HP3 hybridization, again the shape of the molecule or the ion will be octahedral. Here, when 3 electrons the cobalt loses, we will remain with 18 plus 6 means 24 electrons. 18 electrons will be of inner orbit and 6 of penultimate shell, and these 6 are paired against Hund's rule. Actually, there should be one pair and 3 unpaired electrons, or 4 unpaired electrons, but here it is paired, these electrons, 6 electrons are paired. Why? Because ligand molecules are approaching towards the central metal ion. As a result, these electrons are paired against Hund's rule, and the hybridization is B2SP3. This can be shown like this. These are the paired electrons of 3D level of cobalt against the Hund's rule, and these are the accepted pairs of electrons. These pairs are donated by the ligand. 6 ligand means 6 ammonia molecule. 6 ammonia molecule for donating 6 pairs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Of 6, 2 electron pairs are accommodated in 3 B level, 1 in 4S and 3 electron pairs in 4 P level. So these are outer most orbits, these orbits, so 4S and 4P levels are from outermost orbit, and this is from penultimate cell, therefore it is N minus 1D, therefore it is inner orbit complex. Now the outer orbital are ND orbital complexes. This is the second type in the complexes whose molecules are ions have octahedral shape. Here the complex will have sp3d2 hybridization. Why? Because sp3 and d2, all six orbitals from nth level are outermost orbit are valence shell, therefore the hybridization is called sp3d2 hybridization. One of the example is hexa-2-nickel-2-ion, in which six water molecules act as six ligand molecules. Every molecule will give 2 electrons, therefore 6 into 2 means 12 electrons, and nickel is there in plus 2 state, so nickel is having 28 as head of, that is atomic number 28, minus 2 means 26, plus 12, 38, and it is nearly equal to the atomic number of krypton. So the hybridization, type of hybridization, this ion, hexa-2-nickel-2-ion undergo is sp3d2, and the shape of the molecule is octahedral. This is the case with that ion. These are the ions, electrons of nickel, and these are the electrons given by the ligand. This are electrons of nickel ion, and these six water molecules are donating six pairs. All pairs of electrons donated by ligand are accommodated in nth level are 4s, 4p and 4d. One orbital of 4s will have one pair, three orbitals of 4p will have three pairs, and two orbitals of 4d will have two pairs of electrons donated by the ligand. Are these metal ions, that is nickel, is accepted or accepting electrons from water molecules, which is acting as ligand. The last thing, we have discussed two different types, inner and outer d orbital complexes. Two more examples. This one is for outer. This is an ion, complex ion, Fe(F6) fluoride, which is outer, and this is also, and which iron and water. Iron here is central metal ion, and water acts as ligand, that is also outer. For inner, we can take this out of which we have discussed this just now. So this was regarding the molecules of complexes whose structure or shape or geometry is octahedral. Means we discuss the shape of complexes with octahedral only under the heading valence bond here. Okay? Next lesson we will discuss the other shapes of complexes or complexes with other shapes. Today we discuss in detail about the shape of molecules of complexes which is octahedral. So this was regarding valence bond theory. But today let us stop here. So this is the end of the lesson. Thank you. Coming on to meet again with different examples of different structures of complexes. Thank you.